Classic Rock Beagle.
Welcome to the annals of the Classic Rock Beagle. I apologize, Moser is a bit preoccupied. He's celebrating our first segment of programming that wasn't demonetized. Let's play it now. Welcome to the annals of the Classic Rock Beagle. I apologize, Moser is a bit preoccupied. You get the joke. We review music and topics from classic rock era. Today, if we can divert Moser's attention from his income, we'll do another random reviews today. Oh, that's nice of you. Wow. $0.13, Moz. Google it after this episode. Anyways, we'll review a May from a classic rock era. For now, Moser will select the year from the classic rock era using the handy dandy random.org. Random.org, Moz. I'll get it up for you. There you go, Moser. Put it at random.org. And Moser hits 1991. And we'll figure out what we're going to do from late May 1991. Number 5, 10 best songs in Billboard's Hot 100 in end of May 1991. May 31st, 1991. On May 31st, Angolan President José Eduardo dos Santos and rebel leader Jonas Savimbi met in Lisbon, Portugal, to sign the Basese Accords ceasefire agreement, putting a cap on the, at the time, 16-year civil war in Angola. The ceasefire would last exactly 1.5 years until the Halloween massacre in 1992. In Australia, 102-year-old Minnie Monroe married 83-year-old Dudley Reed in Point Claire, New South Wales, making the newly minted Mrs. Reed the oldest bride on record, a record she still holds to this day. I couldn't find whether or not they had any children together. Late on the 30th of May, Magic Johnson seals a Game 6 win against the defending Western Conference champion Portland Trailblazers with a brilliant soft pass to nowhere, leading to the only playoff showdown between Magic and Jordan in the NBA Finals. The number one movie in theaters was Backdraft, starring Kurt Russell and William Baldwin. The number one song on Billboard's Hot 100 on June 1st, actually, was I Don't Want to Cry by Mariah Carey. Good song, but you had to make our great category to make our list, like these 10 songs. As an aside, if the role gave me a 6, it would have been tons of fun to take whacks at some of the bad songs on the Billboard's Hot 100 this week by geniuses like Voices That Care, Timmy T, Gerardo. Hey, listen to his flow and tell me I'm wrong. Hip-hop was in a good place this month. All in all, I was impressed by the rap on the charts this week. No lie, before I remember that there was no honorable mention section in my random reviews episodes, I had 3 rap songs in my HMs. My drunk favorite, CNC Music Factory, is my last cut for this list. Last song to brack this list is this Poser rap song that James Smith pulls off really well. He's trying too hard to be threatening, to be menacing. It has a great beat in production, and despite the great flow and wordplay, it is a really unconvincing thug pose. He just exposes himself as LL Cuddly J. This was a terrible idea. Seriously, who signed off on this? Is there a more untouchable performer than Marvin Gaye? And using early 90s production and an inexplicable medley of some random song?
What the hell were you thinking?
Yeah, that. but Robert Palmer pulled it off. His voice worked perfectly for a straight cover of an amazing song. But this matchup shouldn't have worked. While I enjoyed I Want You, it wouldn't have been near good enough to be on this list by itself. And the 90s isms of the backing tracks didn't distract nearly as much as it should have. Most of all, the lyrics between the two songs do not belong together. No, most of all, you do not replace Marvin. But it worked. I said earlier that hip-hop was in a good place in 1991. You know what? Alternative was also in a good place in 1991. It was rock and pop music that desperately needed a kick in the pants at the time. I must confess that I'm not that familiar with Jesus Jones. They were a two-hit wonder in the US pop chart. Throughout most of the world, Right Here, Right Now is the biggest hit, except for their home country of Great Britain, which was brutal for them. Twice. This was a well-crafted ode to an emerging world with a killer hook. Oh, I'm sorry. You were too busy making an actual number one hit out of this. Come on, Britain. Life is fickle. There were times in my life when I thought the song was overrated.
Man, you have no taste in music.
Well, family, this is not one of those times. In times when I sour on the song, I focus on the dad rockiness of the music or the simple Nothing Burger piano riff, as Todd so delightfully pointed out.
There's basically no easier piano riff in the universe. Chopsticks is harder than the riff from Walking in Memphis. Heart and Soul may as well be Beethoven's 29th Sonata compared to Walking in Memphis.
The music is fine, but in listening to it for this episode, I caught the same fever from Memphis that Cohn had in writing this song. The legacy of Memphis is immense. W.C. Handy's song, The Memphis Blues, spearheaded one of the most important genres of the 20th century. Polka! Memphis Blues, Sun Records, Memphis Soul. Cohn's passion for music is very well expressed. After Christine McVie lit my flame for music, my musical journey has taken me in a very wide direction. Since that point, my musical journey has included a wide swath of musical styles, including...
You are listening to the Dull Religious Music Program.
Sadness was the debut single by a German experimental group Enigma in 1990. It is part of a concept album, 1990, in which the title character is a monk who has to decide between his life and the religious life, or his lust for a young woman. In other words, the story is this.
Winner of the Beijing Film Festival's coveted Crying Monkey Award, Satan's Alley.
But trite cliches aside, Sadness is a balanced early 90s arrangement working an authentic Gregorian chant on its own terms, which is important to doing this right. As a lover of plain chant, I was impressed. Southern rock is not my thing. I live in Jacksonville and I don't like Skinner. Yeah, if rednecks didn't have the aim of stormtroopers, I'd be dead. Anyways, there is a really great exception here with the Black Crowes classic from 1990. Where to start? First of all, Chris Robinson is what Rod Stewart should aspire to sound like. He has a thing called soul, and doesn't sound like someone's emphysema when he sings mid-register. Also, the build is spectacular led by organ and drums. There's not even electric guitar added, which flew in the face of hair metal at the time. The crank it up to 11 attitude would have completely undercut the melancholic story. Classic rock Beaglets, you've just been Rickrolled.
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious.
I've always really liked this song. For all the shit Rick Astley gets, if you evaluate his voice, he is actually good baritone with unique sound. Astley's capable of producing good music with the right song. The classic rock Beagle presents to you the right song, trademark. Co-written with Rob Fisher of Naked Eyes, Cry for Help is a serious song. Again, as was the norm for the time, it is a story focusing on a woman in trouble. Astley chooses to emphasize the human need to rely on each other for support.
Can you dig it?
I do, actually. I think giving and receiving empathy is one of the most important emotions. One of the most important bands to my musical development was Yes. Our first reference to them was this.
One thing I really appreciate about Fleetwood Mac is that they don't follow trends. Believe me, it was excruciating to hear Yes play New Jack Swing.
Don't believe me? Enjoy. I'm starting with this to demonstrate that gems can be found anywhere if the talent is there. Lift Me Up is from the same album. When musicians, the level of Yes talent is on the arc, it can overcome the worst of production. Guitarist Trevor Rabin can be a bit, authoritarian. This is an effective Rabin Yes song, landing exactly 9 out of 10. And by the way, the grades were finalized on May 25th, the day before drummer Alan White passed away. Requiescat in pace, Alan. From a band that is my top 10, and for a future episode, to a band which I really only like one of their songs. The thing is, I really like one of their songs. My musical awakening came about in 1982. At the time, a sub, psy, fringe genre in pop was British New Wave. Don't think so much Duran Duran or Spandau Ballet. Think modern English Depeche Mode and Yaz. I briefly thought this was the same band as the Beat, who are known as the English Beat here in the States. Anyways, this is a roundabout way to say that this song to me sounded like an updated version of Young One's Guest music. This song was catchy as hell. Pat Cashman, tell us who's at number one.
Wainwright!
No need to yell. I had Silent Lucidity in my honorable mentions for the best of the 90s. Although I correctly mentioned Beck's song as my Floyd fix for the list, the orchestration of Silent Lucidity reminded me a lot of the arrangement Uncomfortably Numb. Jeff Tate's vocal was exquisite, bringing a gentle, comforting tone to a 2-octave range. With sincere apologies to my early reference to opera singer Elizabeth Zaroff, known on YouTube as Charismatic Voice, I'll use her analysis of Tate's vocal performance.
He's relating a story that is emotional, but he's not letting himself get too emotional in it. He's allowing the person that is listening to it to experience it from where they're at. There can be a fine line sometimes as a singer between telling a story that you're really emotional about and letting everything that you feel come out, or having just a teensy bit of restraint and having it clearly felt, but letting another person feel and interpret that how they need to. I feel like he's writing that line perfectly.
In addition to Tate's brilliance, Chris DeGarmo's acoustic guitar and the beautiful orchestration helped make this our number one song in the chart on June 1st, 1991.
So that was the 10 best songs in Billboard's Hot 100 at the end of May 1991. So, Moser, judging from your growl, I take it you weren't satisfied with your purchase. Oh, that's too bad, Em. Just think, Moser. You get 13 cents after 2 years. That would be 52 whole cents after 8 years. But, fine. We have an announcement in the Classic Rock Beagle, piggybacking on an idea from CHR83, plug. When we hit 100 subscribers, we'll rank Billboard's year-end number one songs during the Classic Rock era inclusive from 1965 to 2000. Same thing when we hit 200 subscribers, we'll rank the year-end number two songs, and so forth until we rank the year-end number 100s at 10,000 subscribers.
Son, you're on your own.
So if you like the episode, be sure to smash a like below. If you want to make Moser feel better, be sure to subscribe and spread the word about the Classic Rock Beagle. Let us know what an incompetent buffoon I am, and as always, rock on.
We can make it.